knows a lot about the science stuff. Professor Dave explains.
As we discussed in the previous tutorial, hominins evolved in Africa beginning 7 million years ago during the end of the Miocene epoch. As a reminder, a hominin is any animal that is more closely related to humans than it is to chimpanzees. That is to say, hominins are any ape on the human side of the split. Hominins are the first characterized by a reduction in their canine teeth, followed by the suite of traits imperative to bipedalism, meaning walking on two legs. When the paleontology of human evolution was still in its infancy, there was a heated debate raging as to whether bipedalism or big brains evolved first. This question would be answered in 1925 by the Tong child, a fossilized baby of the species Australopithecus africanus. Let's take a step back, though. Australopithecus is a very crowded genus, with numerous universally recognized species and several contested ones. In the genus Australopithecus, we have the broadly accepted Australopithecus anamensis, Australopithecus afarensis, Australopithecus africanus, and Australopithecus sediba. But in addition to these four, some paleoanthropologists have argued for the validity of Australopithecus deiramada, Australopithecus garhi, Australopithecus borel-ghazali, and Australopithecus prometheus. This is a common debate in paleontology at large: how much diversity belongs in a single species. The contested species share quite a bit of morphology with Australopithecus afarensis, an extremely successful and widespread hominin, but they do have a handful of distinguishing characteristics, primarily in the teeth and the minutiae of the face. The categorization of the Australopiths is confounded further by the fact that they may be a sexually dimorphic genus. Recall that Ardipithecus ramidus, a hominin from the previous tutorial, is sexually monomorphic. This means males and females look essentially the same in size and morphology. Australopiths, however, have been argued to be dimorphic. Specifically, males are argued to be significantly larger than females, much like what we see in gorillas or orangutans today. Sexually dimorphic species, as a rule, allow for much more morphologic diversity while still remaining the same species. To avoid confusion and keep things concise, we will be examining the broadly accepted Australopiths. But first, what physical characteristics generally define genus Australopithecus? All the specimens we possess of this genus suggest a hominin that was bipedal on the ground, but still spending some time in the trees. Australopithecus has the entire suite of physical characteristics that define a biped: anterior foramen magnum, bowl-shaped pelvis or sagittally oriented ilia, a valgus knee, and three arched feet with an inline big toe, or hallux. However, these hominins still maintain curved phalanges, and many have a more basal scapula, suggesting they would have still been very efficient climbers. Australopiths have further reduced canine teeth, with no canine P3 honing complex, slightly larger brains than the hominins that came before, maxing out around 550 cubic centimeters, and strong alveolar prognathism, meaning they are snouty. All of this together paints the genus Australopithecus as a relatively small-brained biped. The oldest member of the genus appears 4.2 million years ago in East Africa with Australopithecus anamensis. This species was really fleshed out in 2016 with the discovery of a nearly complete skull, which indicates that Australopithecus anamensis was contemporaneous with a later species, Australopithecus afarensis, which first shows up 3.8 million years ago. Australopithecus afarensis was a wildly successful species, and the species that the famous Lucy specimen belongs to. It is found in East Africa today, but its range may be much larger if some of the contested hominin species end up falling within the diversity of Australopithecus afarensis. In South Africa, we have Australopithecus africanus, appearing at 2.2 million years ago, as well as the late surviving Australopithecus sediba at 1.9 million years ago. Most of the Australopiths were primarily generalists, eating fruits and leaves, and occasionally incorporating grasses and tubers. Meat may have been on the menu occasionally as well, if the opportunistic omnivory of living apes are anything to go off of. As previously mentioned, Australopithecus as a genus is universally accepted as a bipedal ape, at least when it was on the ground. This is known from the morphology we discussed, but also from ichnofossils. Ichnofossils, sometimes called trace fossils, are preserved behaviors such as footprints. The Laetoli trackway is one of the most famous ichnofossils and preserves the footprints of an Australopithecus group traveling across Tanzania some 3.6 million years ago. During this time period, a nearby volcano was undergoing a series of eruptions that repeatedly coated the landscape in a layer of ash. This meant that animals traveling across the ancient savanna had their footprints preserved, and with them, their grouping patterns. The Laetoli footprints are fascinating in part because they reveal a foot morphology much more similar to modern humans than any hominin that came before it, while still maintaining basal aspects. This, of course, cements Australopithecus as a transitional genus with regard to bipedalism. The tracks record a small individual, presumed female, and a large individual, presumed male. The female tracks favor one side, indicating she may have been carrying a weight on her hip. Given that hominins were not carrying toolkits at this point in time, it is likely that this weight was a dependent infant, carried like a modern mother totes around her baby. Inside the male trackway, a smaller set of prints can be found, potentially a youngster taking the path of least resistance by stepping in their father or other male relative's footsteps. It evokes the image of a young human today following their parent in deep snow. Altogether, the Laetoli footprints paint a familiar picture, a human one. Australopiths may have been toolmakers as well. The Lomekwi tool culture found in Kenya can potentially be associated with Australopithecus. Extremely basic but clearly worked stone tools were found in Turkana County with two hominins at the site, Australopithecus and Kenyanthropus. Whether the toolmaker is Kenyanthropus or Australopithecus is not known. We will talk about Kenyanthropus later, but for now it is worth knowing that some propose this genus should be subsumed into Australopithecus. Throughout history, we have typically associated tools with our own genus, Homo. However, it appears as though tool use may have emerged much earlier indeed. As food for thought, the toolkit of modern chimpanzees includes stone hammers and anvils, but the majority of their repertoire is non-lithic or not stone-based. They use vegetation like leaves and sticks to exploit resources much more frequently than they wield stone. As such, it seems reasonable to propose that tool use in general likely precedes consistent lithic use in the fossil record. Australopithecus persisted until around 2 million years ago, and it is generally accepted that two genera split off from these ancestral hominins, our own genus Homo and the oddball genus Paranthropus. Let's move forward and look at this latter genus now.
Thanks for watching. Subscribe to my channel for more tutorials. Support me on Patreon so I can keep making content. And as always, feel free to email me, ProfessorDaveExplains@gmail.com.